I did 3 hours and 20 minutes yesterday. That's just the taping, not counting everything else. And I might be thinking this morning, well, oh, gotta get to take it easy day Saturday. No, not so fast, not so fast. No, the disciplines are difficult to continue, right? Get up stretching. Oh, I gotta do this. Oh, come on. I say, yeah, come on. Stick with it, stick with it. Keep all the habits going right now. This is what will see us through. Good habits get us through. Good habits get us through. The spiritual path is really 24/7. It's 24/7. Have to keep flipping the script. And so let's get right to it, because I know time is very precious right now. Everyone's time is precious. Our trouble is that it's too easy. It's not that it's too difficult. All right, so this is a tremendous paradigm shift. But this is exactly what we need. When we have, for instance, the Cardinal Bergoglio saying that I'm a human animal, I'm a human person, but he also means animus personas, a political animal, and he's proud of it. And this is one belief system. This is called the egoic belief system. Then you have Jesus Christ saying, I am not a body, I am free, I am still spirit, exactly as God created me. Jesus is absolutely adamant, we are not a human person whatsoever. Okay, we're pure, formless spirit, exactly as God created us. It's very cut and dried, very black and white. So that's a different belief system. Call it the Holy Spirit's belief system. So you have these two belief systems now. I guess you're going to have to figure out, people have to figure out, are we going to go with the Pope's belief system, or are we going with the belief system of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit? It's one or the other, really. And when we say, actually, Cardinal Bergoglio, Jorge Mario Bergoglio, this is the worldview of all the world leaders, all the politicians. He's a politician. He's part of the New World Order. Okay, this is the New World Order, that we're a human person, human animal, human person. And we learn about our human animal personness by having dogs. And, you know, this is what we have to choose between. And it's becoming very obvious now. And so this is really like a major freakout day or opportunity for the world. As we, this firestorm about, we're realizing, hey, wait a minute. Not so fast. I don't think I'm a human. I'm a human person. I've never thought I'm a human person. I think that this is absolutely ridiculous. It's a lie. We are not the flesh. Jesus' whole thing is to say we are not the flesh. And here's Cardinal Bergoglio saying we are the flesh. Okay, and from that belief system, the extension of that says, let's do good to the flesh. Let's help the flesh out. Let's, you know, it's all about, and there are, there's books coming out, like in the Catholic Church, there's this book, Remembering Jesus. Everyone's supposed to take it home and read it, and they're going to study the chapters. I read it yesterday. And it was easy to read because I could just see, what is it? It's all about the flesh. Social justice, the flesh, and human person. The author emphasizes that we must need be the best human people, the human persons that we can be, our humanness. We must develop it to the highest extent because this is what God created us for. This is right in line with Cardinal Bergoglio's mission, the New World Order mission. It's totally bogus, okay, from my standpoint. It's completely opposed by Jesus Christ, or Jesus Christ offers a total alternative to the New World Order and the humanistic, secular humanistic belief system, which is all this really is. So don't allow the trappings of religion to pull us down into a secular humanistic belief system, which is a totally false, grievously false belief system. We are not that at all. Now, what we are told, what the Holy Spirit is showing me, is that all of absurdity is absurd, and so we don't need to focus on absurdity so much, okay? It means we don't need to focus on the world at all. The world is just a reflection of an absurdist belief system, that we're not what we really are. So there's no point in focusing on that, really. What we focus on is what we really are. Obviously, if we just focus on what we're not, and shuffle around the parts, okay, well, I'm not this, but and this is less not this than that. If we keep shuffling around what I am not, absurdity, we won't get any familiarity with what we are. And so we must avoid this mistake. So we're not going to analyze the world so much. We understand that there firestorms come up and people are interested in that. But it's not important. It's just more absurdity. It's just more absurdity is all it is. We don't need to pay attention to absurdity. It doesn't help us really. We just need to pay attention to truth. So this is the key message that's coming through right now. I know it's difficult for everyone. It's like, oh my gosh, but I mean, really? Yeah. So let's try to do this. And what the problem is, again, let us understand the problem. It's that it's too easy for us. The fact is, we have never ever developed any real defense against the ease of this at all. And so what we're doing as we focus on the world is we're looking for, well, what defense is actually a good defense? This is what we think we're critiquing the world, but actually subtly we're looking, say, okay, how do I make it more difficult? What's a real defense against the ease of what I am? What's a good defense? And there isn't any. And here is the problem. So we have to identify the problem. I say it's continuity fear, meaning it's too easy to be what we are. There's no defense against it, actually. And this is like, oh my gosh, I've been searching for what I'm not for so long. How can I just easily be what I am? I've been so enmeshed in confusion and complexity and struggle and difficulty. How can that just all vanish? You know, this is a continuity fear. And so we intentionally make it difficult, try to make it difficult, and yet it never is difficult. And so this is the burn, part of the burn that we practice here. The real burn comes to focusing on ease. There's no difficulty at all, actually. I remember the times I've been able to shift into correct perception, and it was like, it was just, as they say, pouring water into water. I said, well, wait a minute, where's the difficulty? You know, how'd I do that? Meaning, what difficulty did I overcome? Well, none, really. I was just willing to accept that it wasn't difficult. So, this is, okay, this is the key. How do we shift and abide when we just realize it's not difficult? And herein lies the difficulty for us. It's not difficult. Now, when we want difficulty, what do? We put our attention back on the world, don't we? Say, oh, what a relief. It's now difficult. I see all this difficulty. I'm feeling difficulty now. Oh, wow. What happened to me? For a while there, I wasn't feeling any difficulty. The false belief system is to say that God made us as these bodies, human beings. That's a false belief system. And within that, we feel all this struggle and difficulty. So if we don't feel any struggle or difficulty, and we have this false belief, we'll say, oh, wait a minute, you know, like, oh my gosh, I kind of took a break from what God created me as. Maybe God was aware of that and is going to punish me. But God doesn't punish me. So we say, oh, good. God maybe was sleeping and didn't realize that I had for a moment kind of taken a few moments off from the difficulty there. We say, wow, that was a close call. And the way that the humanists pray to God is really they're saying, God, please, please, please forgive me if sometimes I lapse, you know, from my humanness and think that maybe I'm something else. I know it's terrible. What's that? I don't know. Okay. Yeah, it's like, and so we're afraid of God. We propitiate God because we think maybe God is aware, like when I'm harboring these secret thoughts that maybe I'm not a human being, a human body, a human person. Maybe I'm not the flesh. And we get real nervous about that. Say, oh God, please, 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 please don't get angry with me. You see how we build up an angry God, a fearful God, from this false belief that God created us flesh, human beings, the world. No, this is all a reflection on our mind of absurdity, human body, this world, nature, all this. This is a reflection in our own mind, in our mind, the one mind, of absurdity. That we want it to be different than reality. Let's see if we can have something different than reality. And this is an absurdist idea. And so this is, the body is simply what we've come up with for now. Within this absurdity, using our creativity to try to make absurdity real. Okay, we're trying to make absurdity real. So of course that's very difficult. But we say, oh no, God told us to do this. God mandated we make absurdity real. So all the struggle that we feel to try to make absurdity real, we believe that this God is saying, you know, oh, they're good. What I have made is good. God looks down and says, oh, human bodies, the flesh, and says, ah, this is really good. They're really struggling. They're really working to make absurdity real. I'm very pleased with my children. This is what we erroneously believe. There's zero truth to any of that. It's absolute absurdity is all it is. So when we are free of struggle and difficulty, we then think, oh my gosh, God is going to punish me. Oh, what if God finds out? Oh my gosh, what God? And then we try to make ourselves crazy. We throw ourselves back into absurdity. We try to freak ourselves out, psych ourselves out, our mind, back into absurdity. So when we say, well, how did I do this? What we mean is, how do I get back to absurdity? How do I get back to difficulty? And we kind of panic because there isn't any way except to go all in, you know? It's either absurdity or not absurdity. So we're flipping the script entirely here, which is necessary. Different way is the right way to view the situation. We've been viewing the situation from the standpoint of absurdity, okay, and trying to hide from ourselves this by trying to fix absurdity and thinking, well, we're struggling, we're making progress, we're doing all this great stuff. And in fact, no, we're just looking at it from the standpoint of absurdity, which doesn't do any good at all. We keep coming up with absurdist conclusions and then marketing them and trying to make the whole world go along with this absurdist conclusions, making us feel better. Then we think, well, so we're doing God's work here on earth, you know. So the idea that absurdity has of God is, of course, absurd. And I know people say, they'd say, oh, I'm praying to God, I ask God for help. They're asking absurdity for help, thinking that God created absurdity. And that's what we are. So this is a belief system. It's a false belief system. Secular, humanistic, false belief system. Materialistic belief system. So we have to go over and over and over this as we keep flipping this script. We keep working on flipping this script. Now, what's the benefit? It doesn't seem to be too much, right? But yet we keep being able to progress more and more and more toward this way. So there is progression. It's kind of like you work out. You say, well, what's the benefit? I still feel sore. I still feel tired. But overall, we're getting stronger. I did that yesterday. I had to carry these buckets full of heavy, heavy dirt and gravel and rock, like if the farmers carry, they call it. I had to carry it, and it was like really heavy. I was able to do it and climb up steps and everything, and a lot of buckets I had to carry, many trips. Maybe each bucket was like, you know, 60 pounds or so. It was quite heavy. But today, you know, like I feel well, a little tired, a little sore, you know, it doesn't hurt, but I did it, you know. Before I couldn't have done that, so I'm getting stronger. You see, getting stronger. Spiritually, getting stronger. And we just have to do this. We have to work out every day. The ones that succeed are the ones that get up in the morning and say, ah, I don't feel like it, but, you know, this is something that I have to do. Because the alternative is so terrible. And it truly is. So if we can't muster up a positive motivation, just muster up one's realizing that the failure to practice like this is grievous. And that should be becoming more and more apparent to the world, just how grievous it is. And I keep asking the Holy Spirit for more help. You know, it seems like it's just, well, get up in the morning and just keep grinding away. Well, we'd like a little more inspiration. We'd like a little more, you know, buoyancy. We certainly would. And it does seem to be very, very difficult. And you know, the help is just hard to fathom, you know. But what can we do? It's tough. There's no question it's tough. And everyone throwing obstacles in your path, which they certainly do. They certainly do. Severe obstacles. Why? They want to make it more difficult. When they feel you're lightening up and it's easy for you, they feel a sense of ease. They don't like that. They want a sense of difficulty. They want to feel struggle, difficulty. And so they'll tie themselves up in knots to give them that feeling of identity. They think that's their identity that God gave them. This is the lie. This is the Luciferian lie. This is the lie of spiritual pride. This lie believes in God. It believes in an absurdist God that created us absurdly. Okay, and that wants us to function absurdly. And it wants us to deny reality. Sure, they believe in that God. And if they try to take it further, they don't believe in any God at all. Any reality at all. It's just all is absurdity. And we're made for absurdity. We're fashioned for it. We love absurdity. This is, you know, this is our home. And they go that far. Really, they do. So I've made great, great prayers. And you know, everything seems like the same. Get up in the morning, you feel tired, you don't get enough sleep, and everything's the same dreary day, the same dreary places and houses and streets and everything, and it's just, wow. Well, I know. But we have to stay positive and do what we can do. We cannot allow inferences of failure to stop us. So, you know, whatever help comes, that's what comes. But we will continue to refuse to make any excuses to fail here. So our goal is abidance. And what is beyond words? What is beyond definition? And we forget, oh, abide in what? We say, oh, abide in what? But abidance, we know. We know. We don't have to try to pin it down. Awareness of the one mind, awareness of awareness, awareness of the one mind. I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit. But we don't have to pin it down. Well, it's more important to keep flipping the script here. Keep flipping the script. Why are we not abiding? Because it's too easy. Okay, this is what I like to emphasize here. Why are we not abiding? We know we're not abiding, right, in a sense of bliss, right, and just in bliss. Why? Because it's too easy. And we think that God will annihilate us, that somehow we've separated from God because we think God is the creator of difficulty. So if we feel this perfect ease, there's a moment where we say, moment of truth there, we think, well, wait a minute. Is this what God created me as, or did I just separate from God? So this is the freak out moment in abidance. Now we can get into abidance and be enjoying it. But in the back of our mind, there's this gravity, so to speak, that comes up pretty quickly and says, wait a minute, you need to get back to what God created you as, otherwise you will succeed in separating. So why don't you just think of this as like some anomaly, You know, this is the humanists think all this is just like an anomaly. This is how they are training themselves to look at it. And this is why I'm saying it's so dangerous this time, because of the mass media, multimedia, mass media. In so many ways, we're under infinitely more pressure than people were in the past, actually. Global tracking, everybody, they're going to track everybody. They know where you are. In the past, nobody knew where you were. You could just wander somewhere, nobody knew where you were. They couldn't find you either. So it's easy to get away from the pressure in the past. Now we can't really get away from it. They want you to see abidance and to see, we'll call it abidance for now. It's a very powerful term. They want you to see experiencing abidance as just a capricious anomaly, as a whim, whimsical anomaly that has nothing to do with our real purpose at all. And in fact, you see the humanists, how they've trained their minds. This is exactly how they already believe. They believe the goal of religion and spiritual path, this is just actually go into a temporary whimsical state that doesn't last very long. And you know, you come out of it and like, wow, that was weird. And they want us to think of it as really weird, like some weird whimsical. And they're training us to believe it's just some brain misfiring of neurons in the brain, that the brain temporarily malfunctioned. And they say, well, occasionally we might be prone to a few incidents of the brain malfunctioning, but don't worry, we have drugs to smooth that out. So we're pretty soon be able to eradicate this malfunctioning of the brain. I'm telling everyone, this is exactly what the secular humanist materialists believe. And this is exactly how they train their mind and belief system. And they've trained it to an extraordinary extent and are continuing to. And this is going to converge with all the various trends. All the trends are converging. So we're going to be in a very bad situation in this world. The pressure. It's a pressure cooker now. You know how you heat up a pressure cooker and at some point the top of the thing starts to steam. The steam comes out. We're really close to the point where it's going to start steaming. Okay. Very close. Probably just, a few months away at this point. I think it's like, February 20th today, something like that. Yeah. 2:16. Very close due to the pressure point. The pressure now is steaming. And at that point, we start being cooked. Our belief system is going to start being cooked, meaning they're going to cook it towards believing that it's just a brain anomaly, a misfiring on the nervous system that produces a hallucination. And it's very unwanted to say this is really... This causes antisocial behavior and all sorts of problems. It's a mental illness, disease. We're super close to an overall acceptance of the world of this. So the Holy Spirit knows this. Jesus knows this. The great teachers know this. That we are at a breaking point. The straw that breaks the camel's back. It's a very important analogy. Where you just keep piling pieces of straw at a time, and you think, oh, everything all will be fine always. No, you get a million pieces of straw on the camel's back, and it's extraordinarily heavy. You put million in one, million in two. At some point, the camel's back cannot support it. Cannot support it. So they just keep piling pressure, more and more pressure, more and more pressure. That's all they know how to do. They're fixated on this. So this is an extraordinarily bad situation because their whole goal is to dismiss abidance. This is what they're targeting. So you might go into abidance, into bliss, into the silence, into bliss, into the effortlessness, into pure spaciousness, seeing that all is just ornamentation of its own spaciousness. Everything is just eternal life as it is. Seeing truth, really. Abiding in the seeing of truth. We may go into that and then we say, oh my gosh, this is like I'm temporarily crazy. How do I get back? And then we start thinking, okay, well, how did I get here? So a lot of the spiritual path right now is so tinged with humanism that we're trying to figure out, well, how do we get there so that we can get back into humanism, dismiss it quickly. And So our efforts are kind of misguided. What we need to do is to focus on the wow of it's just like, it's perfectly easy. There's no difficulty to it. Now this, getting to this is profound, and we've gotten to it. Because this really is the heart of our fear, is it not? That we won't find a way to get out of it. Because of the false belief system, the belief that God created us as an absurdity, and the severe confusion and difficulty that comes with absurdity. And that if we're not feeling that, we've broken off communication with God. We're no longer have a relationship with God. But seeing truth is the relationship with God. So what we've done is become aware of our true relationship with God. That's what's really taken place. And it's effortless. So we may get a wow glimpse now, like, wow, I got a glimpse. I say, oh, I can see a few issues that have tripped us up. That's okay. There are some tripper uppers in the world who, you know, can get clever with this. But that's okay, because that's expected too, right? That's part of absurdity. So we will get past that, okay? Let us not struggle with it. Because it's completely easy. Absolute ease, you might say, enlightenment. Absolute ease. There's no difficulty at all to knowing what we are, to experience what we are. And this has been the difficulty all along. This is why we come into the world, and we may be experiencing, maybe we may see reality as I did to some extent. And people hear relentlessly against that. And they say, no, you need more difficulty. A lot of times for me, everything was easy. They say, it shouldn't be so easy. You know, let's give you something more difficult. You're advanced. Okay, let's put you in an advanced curriculum, so you can challenge you. You're not being challenged enough. You're not, because I don't feel a sense of identity yet. You haven't developed an identity here. You know this is how it goes, isn't it? This world's an insane asylum. Literally, the words of Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma was that this world is an insane asylum. And as you come into the insane asylum, the inmates here want you to be like them, because they think that this insanity is their identity. And they think, oh my gosh, you're someone who doesn't have an identity. Let us help you. Let us help you. Well, we know how to get an identity. We have an identity with God-given identity of struggle and difficulty, confusion and death and impermanence and human and fleshness and vulnerability. So we know that. We know how to give you an identity. We created you. We made you flesh. So we'll give you a flesh identity. This is insanity. So you could say the world is just a cuckoo's nest. It is. And into this cuckoo's nest, we project an appearance we call the flesh body, but it's just an appearance of light, that's all. It's not a creation at all. The creation is spirit. So again, it's that the problem is it's too easy for us. We think it needs to be difficult. To relate to the inmates here. But we don't really want to relate at that level. We want to relate at the level of truth. We don't want to believe in lies like the insane do, because then we're one of them. And then we think, oh, I can't stop doing that. I'll lose my identity. So what's the problem again? It's that it's too easy. In fact, it's complete easement. We make the shift, and it's just all easement. That is it. There's no continuity fear anymore. Not in the easement, not in reality. Reality doesn't generate it. But the old continuity fear from the false belief system calls back to us, says, come back home, we'll welcome you with open arms. We have treatments for what your problem. Don't worry, we'll forgive you for your transgressions. God is a forgiving God, and God will forgive you for having strayed from his mandate. So they misapply forgiveness. They misapply all this. What we need to forgive ourselves for is straying into insanity and putting, arrogating something to God which is not part of God, which is God mandating that we be absurd and believing that God created us absurd. That's what we need to forgive ourselves for this ridiculous, whimsical belief that we have. So the world has it upside down and backwards, but they're very adamant about it. What is our problem again? It's too easy. And so what do? We make it difficult. So what do we need to do? We need to stop making it so difficult, which I call thinning out the ice of difficulty. What is it? The ice breaks, it means, oh, I'm in easement now. I'm not in some terrible abyss, I'm in easement. But difficulty views easement as an abyss of non-identity. I mean, the world is so cuckoo, it can't even tell us what the weather's going to be. I went online last night, and I viewed all the weather sites, and every single one of them said, clear, a few clouds, or zero precipitation, nothing. Well, it rained. It's cold, it's miserable, it's wet, it's damp. I mean, this would be nice to know, but they can't even get that right. It's pretty bizarre. We could send this someone, you know, we could send all these spaceships to planets and etc. But we can't tell us, hey, it's going to, you know, there's going to be some rain. I mean, it was raining, literally. I looked at all the different weather channels. I looked at the radar. No rain. It didn't show any rain. Nothing. And it was outside, it's raining. I said, wow, how great is technology? It's pretty bizarre. Anyway, I interject some hubris, always hubris, to speak of the foibles of technology, but reminding ourselves it's madness. This world is a place of utmost madness, zany, bizarre, whimsical absurdity, actually. And trying to solemnify this and, you know, like, this is what God, we're so... Thank you, God. We go to church, you know, every week or day and say, thank you, God. Thank you so much for creating me as a human being, as creating me as flesh here, putting me in this world. I just want to make sure I don't run astray of what your mandates for me are. So could you please clarify your mandates for me a little bit more? Because sometimes, you know, I seem to stray. And I seem to think that maybe I'm actually spirit, you know. And so, of course, the churches and religions have seen... They realize, wait a minute, you know, we don't want to crack the whip too hard. So let's say, well, God made you both spirit and flesh. Dual nature, yes, both spirit and flesh. And that's what you really are. But you got to make sure that, you know, well, what that's like God made you both truth and absurdity. And so they try to accommodate it, like say, well, we're not going to be too tough on you when you stray, when you start thinking of yourself as spirit. We say, well, you know, that's okay, kind of, but also you got to realize you're the flesh, you know. But of course, one denies the other. So ultimately, if you try to follow this Chalcedonian creed of Jesus was both human and divine, you end up with total confusion, chaos in your mind. So when we try to make the world true, which I did, you end up with total mental chaos. So really the goal the world has is it tells you can be happy with this belief system. Is it's pushing you to total mental chaos or lethargy. So to avoid total mental chaos, you need to be lethargic and a zombie, basically. So I can't even try. Yeah, I can't really even try. Just, you know, eat and sleep and you know, work, but I can't even try. This is a defense against mental chaos, actually. So for me, I said, no, I will not be lazy. So I'm going to realize the happiness of this world. And in trying to do so, trying to bring together truth and lies, you end up with total mental chaos. I said, wow, that's not possible. I said, holy, wow, I need help. And the Holy Spirit showed up and said, okay, let me help show you what the truth is here and why this trouble is the way it is. So secular humanism is just going towards this blahness, this horrible homogenized blahness. And you're feeling it, right? I mean, I go, wherever I go, I just notice people. I'm sitting in a car looking, and I can tell everybody is just this homogenized, disengaged blahness. Their mind has just been pureed, you know? It's very true. And we're only alert and really into it along certain lines that the humanism allows us to say, okay, this is okay. Let's, you know, get after more roboticism. You're doing okay. You can be real focused and intense on that. But in terms of a naturally disposed awareness, you don't see it. In fact, you see the opposite. Yeah, I see people going to the supermarket. It's just what they're shuffling in like zombies. I mean, I could shoot a film, but I could call it, you know, zombie market. And everyone will say, wow, where'd you get those actors and actresses? That's amazing. No, I'm just filming cinema verite. You know, put it black and white, put some grunge on it, filter or something, and a scary soundtrack, and everybody would say, oh my gosh, what a brilliant filmmaker. Who are these actresses and actors? I want to hire them for my film too. No, I just, you know, went out here in the countryside and, you know, went to market and just filmed it. That's true. Absolutely is true. I said, what am I watching here? It's zombie land here. And there's a reason for that. It's a defense against mental chaos, which is the direction of happiness that humanism gives us results in mental chaos. So we're afraid of happiness. You see, we're terrified of happiness. We say, I don't want the happiness of God. You know, if we think God created us absurdity, and then we think, well, in order to accommodate this sort of our mental illness, we have to say, yeah, well, your spirit too. It's accommodation. And they say, well, you can be happy. You're both. And say, okay, well, in order to be truly authentic, I'm both. Then you want to realize that the complete authenticity of both, this results in mental chaos. And I've been there, so I know exactly what I'm talking about here. And so we become afraid of happiness. Happiness becomes this demon of mental chaos. Oh, I want to avoid that. So what is it? Sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Fake happiness. Let me just sensations. Let me just feed my sensations. Yeah, but my sensations are tired and I don't feel very good today. And, you know, give me some sausage and some beer and sausage and turn on the television. And oh, but I can go to work and be a good bean counter, you know, or teach the kids how to be insane too. Oh, yeah, I can focus on that. Okay, now I feel a little more alive. But we're very circumscribed in our awareness. We don't have this total, naturally disposed awareness that is just everywhere, right? In every moment, we have this aliveness. We don't have that. This is really what the teachers are like, the great teachers, the ones who have accepted the ease of being, the true ease of being. This is what they're like. They're always just simply aware, naturally disposed in this beautiful, smooth awareness that isn't jagged, isn't circumscribed by you know, blinders. You know, you can only be, you know, your awareness has to be channeled into this to avoid happiness, to avoid easement, to avoid mental chaos, which trying to combine truth and lies produces mental chaos. So These are the troubles that we actually have, the fears that we actually have. So we're bringing these fears to light and easily, naturally explaining them. And you could just say, like, wow, thank God that we're seeing this now, that this is being brought to light. We don't want this to be submerged, do we? This is so important. This clarity is so important. We don't want it submerged. We don't want it dismissed. We're going into a dismissal society, a dismissal destiny, a destiny of dismissal, of dismissing reality. This is what secular materialistic humanists are all about, and they're making their play. I mean, the Pope was criticized, well, Cardinal Bergoglio was criticized. Trump called him a politician. He's a politician. And then he very cynically said, well, maybe I am a pawn, just a little, just being played for a pawn here, and I'm just a politician, I'm just a pawn. Maybe I am. Who knows, you know? But, you know, maybe, you know, we'll leave it up to people to think of, they can think about how they want to think about it, you know, and we'll see. I mean, he's like, basically, you know, he's not denying it at all. And everybody's like, what? Absurdist. An absurdist answer. He's an absurdist. As are most people in the world, most of us here. But some of us are saying, you know, whoa, wait a minute. Now, in my case, I tried to embrace the world ideology and get happiness out of it, true happiness, and I found it led to total mental chaos, which then I had to back away from it. Says, wow, that doesn't work. Well, where do I find happiness then? And that's when the Holy Spirit arrived in my life, the awareness of the Holy Spirit. It was always there. I didn't ask for help. And then it said, don't worry, I will bring you to true happiness. I promise you. And we shall not fail. And the Holy Spirit said, for me, it's already a done deal. It's a done deal. It's just you have this continuity fear, and you need to evaporate this fear, okay? And the continuity fear has these areas that we're looking at of, like, we, you know, by believing in the false belief system, we end up arriving at false conclusions. And that we need to avoid happiness. We need to stay in this difficulty, unhappiness, because we think happiness is actually this mental chaos of combining truth and lies, thinking that we have to integrate. We have an integration problem. We need to integrate. You know, you call this integral yoga, integral philosophy, integral this, integral psychotherapy, you know, integral. This is the egoic belief system. And of course, they never quite succeed. And they keep channeling their, well, let me write 10 books. Let me do this. And let me awareness. There's never this naturally disposed awareness, resting freely, total easement of naturally disposed awareness. This is our identity. Total non-absurdist. Okay, we're not integrating anything at all. So I don't want to rush us too much here. I mean, I've brought to light what needs to be brought to light here, and it's easy. And then again, this is what scares us, the ease. We think it's an abyss. But that's using the old belief system's premise that God created absurdity, God's absurd and created us as absurd. That's a false premise. So if we use the old premise to try and clarify truth, we'll reach an absurd conclusion. We'll think that easement is an abyss, and that it's separation from God. And then we'll try to say, wait a minute, you need to combine truth and lies, integrate it, and for happiness, and then we'll feel total mental chaos, then we'll get frightened of happiness, and then defend and protect ourselves against it. And then you spiral back down into this hideous, hideous black hole of secular humanistic materialism, which you become a zombie. I mean, you function as a zombie. Your awareness, your attention, everything is so circumscribed. Blinders. You become a horse with blinders on, pulling this heavy carriage all your days, hoping that death will liberate you from this, and it doesn't. It's a little chilly out here, to say the least. I didn't really wear enough. I'm always optimistic in California. This is I didn't take my phone with me. Well, I did not. How about that? Uh-oh. I didn't? I thought I did. Well, I did not. Well, good. I'll get in trouble, though, later on. We gotta stay in touch, or we gotta keep the difficulty going. This is not a joke. In terms of people afraid of happiness, they think it's mental chaos. Well, of course, if it was trying to combine truth and lies, it would be. And when we try to do that, it is. But that's not what we're trying to do here. We're saying that lies are lies and truth is true. And God is God of truth, not a God of absurdity and lies. So God did not create us as absurd. God created us as truth, and truth is easy for truth, is it not? It's the trying to integrate with lies that's difficult. And we think, well, that's how we have to find happiness, because we have to believe that God created us as absurdist. This is what the false belief system believes. Now, don't struggle with this. Don't worry. It's very clear. It's very clear. And we're getting there. We're getting there. Don't say, oh my gosh, I forgot. This is so, I know it's so important. No. Stay in the wow. Stay in the wow. Have faith. Holy Spirit knows the truth. There is this wow here, okay? And this will get you, cause you to lose sight of what was just said. Wait a minute, I can't remember what was just said. That's fine. It was already said. So we're bringing up this whole constellation of resistance now. This very, you know, this ball of confusion, of misconclusions, false conclusions. We're bringing it all up to the light. And it's enough to just do that. We say, okay, I'm bringing it up to the light. Okay. That's some powerful work. Like, it's a powerful workout. It is recording. Great. This has been recorded. Now, we might think, I'm like, okay, let's go. Well, of course, we're under pressure, yes. But first, let's take a little while for this wow, you know, to settle in and so we feel comfortable with this information. It's extremely profound. I love this information. For me, it's better than even what I get in books and teachings. It's better. The books and teachings are very good, very great, but you can only say so much when you write it down in a book. When you're doing this type of video, you can go back and correct. It's much more powerful, actually. Much more powerful. You can stop. You can start. You can full stop on the wow. It's alive. It's much more alive because we're doing it here. And we're feeling the difficulty of it. And we're addressing that in real time, in real moment by moment here. So it's more powerful than reading a book. That's why I do prefer it. I do prefer this, even though it may seem more difficult, because the book is more difficult, and this is easier. So it's more wowy. It's more scary. Like, oh my gosh, this is easier. Uh-oh. That's why people avoid it. They say, give me a book. Can't you write me a book? Can't you write a book? I want a difficulty. I don't want someone who's able to, you know, be aware and nuance it and react and, you know, help in this way. It's too easy. It's too effective. We don't want effectiveness. We don't use it. That'll lead to mental chaos. I mean, I know happiness is mental chaos. Oh my gosh. So let's just act like we're getting there and let's get a book and let's say I got the book on the bookshelf and I read it, you know, and let me make sure I keep my awareness, you know, very much boxed in. False conclusion. So let us celebrate that we've gotten to this insight, tremendous insight. It is a tremendous insight, what we've done right here. It's the best ever. you know, that I've done. And for me, it's just, it's tremendous to bring up and just examine just the fabric of delusion like this. And just say, oh, I could see that. Now I see how it fits together. Oh, no wonder why I've had trouble. Now I see it. It's a blessing. It's a blessing for me to be able to see this and talk about it. And it's just a willingness to make the effort is what it's all about. And just all the effort, you know, I'm in good shape. I say, okay, I want to take a run up a hill. I can do it. Let's run up this hill. I was looking at this hill on the golf course, and real steep, and I was thinking, well, maybe I should just go up that hill. I could have. And maybe I should have. I don't know. But I just looked, and I said, well, I can do that. It's not a problem. Whereas before, the idea of going up that hill, it was ludicrous. It never even occurred to me. It's like the hill is like this massive, oh, I didn't even see it all. It was amazing. I stand there. And recently, and I just looked at this hill, and I just saw the whole hill, and it looked small to me. I said, oh, it's not such a big deal. I can go up there easily. Whereas before, it was this dark, foreboding, massive, and don't even look at it, because don't even think about it. Don't even think about it. But I looked, I said, I can run up that hill, probably. I can just go up there, no problem. I can do that. It won't take long. I had my good pants on, though. I didn't want to do it. But if I had some rugged pants on, and you know, I might have just said, okay, let me just go right up this hill and see what kind of view I get from up there. Just a little hill. It's steep, but it's no problem. So this shifts perspective very much so. So we're looking at this hill of problems now. What seemed to be this mountain, massive mountain, as Longchenpa says, this massive mountains of samsara. Let us level those mountains. May all wandering beings level the mountains of samsara, conditioned existence, delusion, and experience supreme, peaceful bliss. And we level them by just looking at them like this and becoming clear about the difference, you know, difference between an absurdist belief system and a non-absurdist belief system. True premise, false premise. False conclusions come from a false premise. And when we apply those false conclusions to truth, that's when we struggle and we don't abide. We say, uh-oh, happiness, I'm happy. Okay, oh, the mental chaos must be coming soon, you know. No, because we're not trying to integrate it with lies. Or, oh, this means I'm separate from, trying to separate from God. Or, oh, this means I've had a mental breakdown. Oh, or the, see, all these false conclusions, when we buy into those, then we panic and we jump back into absurdity. Like, well, there's something wrong. There was something wrong with it. There's nothing wrong with it. And we say, well, there's something wrong with it. Then we think, okay, I got to go back on the spiritual path. I got to figure out, you know, what's wrong with reality. Maybe we got to fix it. There's nothing wrong with it. It's these false conclusions that we're pulling into from this old absurdist premise, and that was just a whimsical idea we had, spirit had. We're pulling those into our experiencing and drawing false conclusions. And we think, well, I must have left reality because there's a problem there. No. I accepted a false conclusion about it from absurdity. So this is the wow factor has now arisen, and it's just this recognition, the shock of recognition. Wow. The trouble is then when you try to help others, they want the difficulty, and you have to somehow make it seem difficult enough for them, and yet at the same hand harp on the truth, which is what, you know, teachers, great teachers, this is the challenge that they have. But for us, we don't have to be great teachers right now. Let us just abide in truth. And if someone, you know, wants, well, how do I make it more difficult? Well, you could go like to A Course in Miracles, something like that, right? Or whatever you find, and get words. You know, you can use words for it if you want. Go ahead. I'm just showing you, showcasing you that ultimately it works, that you can prevail against absurdity. You can free yourself from it. So I'm just functioning as an example, exemplar, but not at this point as a great teacher. Because everybody comes to the teacher and says, how do I make it more difficult? It's too easy. How do I integrate truth and lies? How do I, you know, all these faults, needs they have, and they say, well, how do I fix what was wrong with reality? Why I'm not abiding it? It must be there's a problem with it, obviously. they come with all these absurdist questions. They really do. But we're under too much pressure right now, really. I mean, not too much, but a tremendous amount. So we have to keep working out on this. You cannot just slough it off and say, okay, I've done enough. Well, you know, like when your house is on fire, or like there's a massacre taking place, don't you flee it? I mean, what do you say? Well, I'll run a few steps, you know. Oh, but now I'm, you know, I get tired of it. Well, there's a terrible massacre all around. You know, flee it. When there's a house on fire, don't say, well, let me go to this room. Let me walk into this room. Let me sit down on the sofa now. Take a break. Take a nap here. No, we don't do that, do we? We flee the burning house. This house of the world is burning down. What's the burning down? It's burning down truth. It's burning down. Its dismissal tries to burn down all momentum towards truth. It dismisses it. We're in a dismissal culture. Culture of dismissal. And so instead of trying to analyze every trend, let us realize just this is the purpose. The purpose. We're recognizing what this purpose is. Turn us into zombies. This is what will happen, actually. And most are already zombies here. Now, we can seem to be alive, I mean, in very circumscribed ways. You know, for some, it's shopping. Let's go shopping. Let's dress up in fashionable clothes. Let's do this. And walk around. Like, oh, I'm alive. You know, like, but anything outside of that, and they're like dead. They're like a zombie. So deadness is everywhere in this society. You feel if you go outside your circumscribed awareness, you're going to die. So you go into the sort of dead, comatose state. It's amazing. I've been into some very beautiful places, and I want people to come there and say, just come here, feel the peace, feel, wow, the beauty. This will help you get ready for a higher realm. And They can't do it. They can't do it. And when I try to drag them there, it's like, this is it's outside their circumscribed functionality of awareness in this false belief system, where they feel it's necessary to avoid mental chaos, to avoid happiness, which they think is, in an absurdist system, happiness would be mental chaos, wouldn't it? So they say, I don't want to be that happy. So, in the deep down, they know awareness is happiness. So they say, I better circumscribe my awareness. I don't want there to be just have this beautiful, total awareness. Oh no, that, because an absurdist conclusion would be that, that must be mental chaos. So we mix the two conclusions up, trying to make them both true. And we arrive at absurdist conclusions in doing so. And so we don't have to say much more. We just have to harp on this. It's gets simpler and simpler and simpler. The trick is to don't try to make it more difficult. Let's hold the center. This is the difficulty of it all. There was this big circular disc at a carnival funhouse. It used to be up by San Francisco, Ocean Beach, I think. It's huge. It must have been like 30 feet in diameter or something, and it would spin around, and so everyone would get on this disc and sit down and start spinning slowly, and centrifugal force or centrifugal force to pushing you away. Eventually people start sliding off. It was kind of a slick wood, so you'd slide off, and it was padded all around, so you'd slide off, and people go, whoa, there you go. You'd tumble as you slid off. And the kids, we just loved it. It was so much fun. But I said, let me try to see if I can stay on this. And so, ultimately, I was able to, just tremendous focus and determination, I was able to stay on it no matter how fast it spun. I didn't spin out. I was the only one on this disc. I was going around and around and around, and I didn't fly off. I was able to stay centered, you see. So I didn't get spun off into circumscribed awareness. I said, let me see if I can stay centered in truth. And the operator was quite upset with me too. Like, what's the matter with you? Everybody, I can get everybody to fly off this, but what happened? You got stick 'em on your shoes, or it didn't go down well with people. They said, this is not right, because this was an exercise in fleeing from truth, okay, and accepting a zombified existence with your awareness functions okay, with just some small parameters. I am this, okay, small parameter. Whereas I said, no, I'm going to see if I am everything. My awareness is not going to be circumscribed. I was able to do it. So I said, okay, this is my destiny. I can do it, but in this world, but it's extremely difficult. Or actually, it's extremely easy. And therein lies the difficulty, because everyone here is worshiping difficulty as if it's their savior. And from a false premise, the conclusion that this difficulty is our savior is logically consistent, okay, with the false premise. And so we think, well, this must be true. Except the premise is false. And so we need to look at this with the eyes of reason and just be able to just look at this. Oh, okay, I see this. It's easy. Oh, I don't want it to be easy. And then we say, oh, now I don't see it anymore. So the wow kind of prevents us from retreating back in the difficulty. What we do is we say, oh, it was easy. And then wow shocks. Oh my God, wait a minute. Easy, what does that equate to? And we start, doing these equations. It does it. So we say, okay, I'm going to full stop in the wow. I'm not going to equate it one way or the other. I'm just going to say, wow, this is really intense. This easiness is very intense. I feel its intensity. Wow. Full stop in the wow. And this is the capacity. That's how I stayed on this circular disc as it was spinning. I was like, wow, this is very intense. But I say, okay, I'm going to just stay in the intensity of this. And my mind was so strong when I was young, I was able to do that. Don't conform. All these people are flying off, but it's just conformity. I don't have to fly off. I don't have to go with the crowd. And everybody had flown off. I was all by myself. Said, wow, this is difficult, because who wants to be seen as an outlier, an anomaly? You know, who wants to be seen in this world just an anomaly? Oh, it's just an anomaly. You know, don't pay attention. It was just an anomaly. There's nothing there to see. Oh, yeah, nice person, nice, very blissed out, peaceful, but just an anomaly. You know, it's not. There's nothing of any value there. It's. It will. You know, eventually it will be integrated into. You know. Absurdity. It's just one of those anomalies. There's some, you know, his brain's not functioning properly. Don't worry about it. You know, we'll just, nothing to see here. Let's move on. This is the world. This is the world. And this is how they view enlightened. This is why they pay no attention to the enlightened ones. It's just a superficial anomaly is all it is. And we'll be able to cure that pretty soon. We're working on it. Got some really nice research universities around the world. You know, UCSF is where I was probably working on it right now. I mean, it's heavily funded, isn't it? I mean, it keeps getting, what, $200 million grants and stuff like that from alumni, tech alumni, who invented some little software gadget or something. And, oh, yeah, you do more research. Let's make sure that nobody's left behind. You know, United Nations, 17 Sustainable Goals. What is it? 2030, nobody left behind. Nobody left behind. This is their mantra. It says, don't worry, there won't be any more anomalies. Nobody will be left behind in Anomalyville. And they're terrified of Anomalyville. And like, I'm like, there's not many people dwelling in Anomalyville these days, is there? That's why Jesus may say, hey, you know, let's go to a reduced intensity zone where there's many dwelling there. And you won't feel like you're such an anomaly. You won't feel like an anomaly there. In zombie land, the non-zombified one is an anomaly. They'll look and say, oh, we must bring this anomaly into the fold. You know, this is why the zombie movies are so popular with kids, because they realize this is what I've experienced. I came into this world and my awareness was free, and I realized everyone here's a zombie, and they zombified me. I mean, the movies that kids watch, the scary movies, the zombie movies, this is because this is what they're experiencing. This world is a very scary place to them. It, indeed it is. Because everyone here is insane. Certifiable. And yet logically consistent with an absurd premise, with the premise that God is absurd and God created us as absurd, as flesh, as to die, and that... And to think absurdly, and we think this is true. We must not separate from God. We must not separate from our being, our identity. And the problem is we've accepted that our identity is an absurdist identity. And then we're logically consistent with that, and then we claim we're not insane. But to accept an absurd premise is insanity. It really is. It really is insanity. That obscenity is obscene. It's obscene, obscene. Obscene insanity. It's an obscenity. Just going to word, obscenity. It's a good one. A combination of obscene and insanity. It's obscenity. What an obscenity. New word. New word just entered the lexicon. It's a good one. I could come up with new words constantly, really. And this is the free awareness. Oh, you can't do that. We've already circumscribed what the words are. You must stay with it. And as you're a kid, you say, I can play with words. And adults say, no. So they want to narrow you down. And the kids are saying, oh, this is horrible. And then when they do that, all this fear and anger rises within their psyche, and then they have to have these movies that project it onto these, you know, slasher movies, all these scary movies. Okay, there's, you know, my anger and fury is it's in the movies, that person and the projection. They teach them projection and all this stuff. It is a lunatic asylum here. And yet, the Holy Spirit is completely with us entirely. you see. And reality is still perfectly real. And the ease of reality is still perfectly available for us and true for us. Truth is still 100% true. It's just like we've gone into this nightmarish dream. Something like that, right? It's like a dreaming of a pit, and there's no pit. We're still on solid ground, completely. We're still on the foundation of reality. We never went into any pit at all. And so as we realize this, oh, that's easy. I don't even have to get out of the pit, right? We're thinking, it's so difficult to climb out of that pit. How do we climb out of this pit? You know, wow. So brutally. And yet, the realization is, oh, there's no pit. There never was any pit. So there's no difficulty at all to climb out of any pit. So ease, I'm at ease now. I don't need to know anything about climbing out of pits. There aren't any pits, there never can be. And then, but the trick, that's easy to say, the trick is abidance, is to not entertain these faults, these absurdist conclusions about your situation, about abidance. This is the difficulty, this is what I'm seeing now. Say, okay, but just seeing it, say, okay, we don't have to do it this instant. It's first, see it. Oh, okay, so these are the obstacles. And stay confident about it. Stay in the wow. Say, wow, great. Wonderful to see this. We've seen the boogeymen, the boogey women. Oh, you know, it's just the zombies. They're coming for you. Okay, this is how the zombies try to zombify you. Okay, great, now I see this. It literally is like this in terms of the fear, like the zombies coming for us, and they're going to turn us into zombies. I mean, bring us out of abidance. Here, let us help you. Let us ask these questions. Let us make it more difficult. We can see your anomaly. You don't want to dwell in Anomalyville. Come into our land. You know, we're coming for you. Come into our land. Let me ask you a question. Oh, here come the zombies. Inside is, oh, shoot, I want to stay in abidance, and yet, you know, well, right? So let's just recognize that this is the crux of it. The crux of it. We want to stay in abidance. It's a given that going into abidance, let's say it's perfectly easy, actually. So let's not even worry about that. Okay? Let's not worry about, how do we climb out of a pit that doesn't exist? That's not the point at all. What we want to keep seeing that the pit doesn't exist. Right? We can see, it's easy to see that it doesn't exist, but we want to keep seeing that it doesn't exist. And this is where the absurdist conclusions are dragging us back into the belief there's a pit. Come back into the pit, you know, the pit dwellers, the zombie pit dwellers, they climb up, they're reaching out, let me grab hold of you, pull you back into the pit. And you're saying, oh, get away, I don't want to go back in the pit. But no, we say there is no pit. Never has been. How do we keep seeing this fact? Is basically, what you're seeing is your brothers and sisters in spirit are just standing there, sitting on the ground, and they're in this dream, and they're having these nightmares, and they're screaming, oh, I must drag you back into the pit. But if you look, you see there isn't any pit anywhere. What frightens us is that we think, well, but God, they're insane. And so then you want to agree with what they're saying so you don't get the shock of that they're insane. We want to say, oh, I see the pit now. Okay, you're not insane. But no, there is no pit. So we have to recognize that they're being absurd. Absurdity gives rise to this functional insanity. It's called functional insanity. Absurd premise gives rise to functional insanity, which we call like a zombie. So now we have some nice words. Functional insanity. Functional obscenity. Functional obscenity. Obscene and insane. Functional obscenity. And another word. Functional insanity. Functionally. It's so absurd premise drags us into this functional insanity. I remember I had a dream where I had a dream where I was enlightened, and I came across this someone who was this yogi, and he was, you know, sitting there and acting like a yogi, and dressed in, you know, like a loincloth or something, and sitting in lotus posture, and they're chanting all this stuff and saying all this stuff, jabbering away, and I said, wow, I think this one is acting very insane, actually, and I wonder if I can help. And And they're gesturing to me and talking to me. I was like, what? What are they talking about? I don't understand at all. This is like gibberish. It's gibberish. I said, but then I got kind of nervous and frightened. I got to understand the they're insane. I got to understand what they're saying. What are they saying? It's just functional insanity. It's just gibberish. Not saying anything, really. They're basically saying, there's a pit, mental chaos. I'm trying to be mental, trying to hold this mental chaos as happy as I'm having trouble. Maybe I could find a way to be happy in mental chaos. You know. And so it unnerved me. And I lost the enlightenment, lost the abidance. Whew. Yeah. So we have to be able to abide even though somebody's just throwing gibberish at us. Which really all the question of the world basically is gibberish. It is gibberish. It's like, how do I fix absurdity? How can I make absurdity real? It's functional gibberish. Functionally insane gibberish. Okay. So we have to just not engage with it at that level at all. And the teachers might say, okay, just be quiet for a while. Right? That's the first step. Just don't keep throwing all this stuff up there, something's gonna stick. And what throws us off is when we see somebody with the spiritual trappings doing this, we think, oh, I mean, what they're really saying is, you see, truth is insane. So if you dress up like I'm a yogi, you know, I'm in meditation, but I'm insane, you know. So truth is insane. So they're trying to, because absurdity is saying the truth isn't insane. So they're trying to integrate the two. So they're making this effort to integrate, and so they look like a spiritual, you know, some spiritual master. So and yet they're insane, you know, they're gibberishing. They're trying to integrate the two. You see, so you can just say, okay, look, you don't. There's no need to integrate truth and lies. Oh, I can't be happy, you know. So you have to understand there's these false conclusions that they're drawing, and they're trying to make it work for them. And we cannot get unnerved by this. And it's not necessarily true that somebody who seems to be very spiritual is trying to integrate it and being gibberish is more advanced than somebody who isn't appearing to be spiritual at all. Because they may have already seen through that. You know, and said, oh, yeah, that's ridiculous. That doesn't work. Most of the time I dress like a sportsman. You know, a sportsman. You know, I don't go out with malas and, you know, disheveled and half undressed and long hair and, you know, ornamentations of spiritual religious things, and you know, I could if I wanted to, but you know, no, just functionally in this area, you don't dress that way. Nobody does. You never see that at all. Hey, you know, and that's I could do that, no problem. Yeah, I'm not attached to any particular look, but I'm aware of all this stuff. I don't appear to be some yogi, right? I could grow a beard, you know, white beard, long hair, and I could really look, I could look the part. Sure, absolutely, of course. We all can. We all can. It's not necessary. It's not necessary at all. What the work we're doing here right now is way more advanced than the work that yogis do. Way more advanced, actually. We're just simply recognizing exactly as it is. What is it that's interfering with abidance and seeing it very clearly? That's all we're doing. So we've simplified it. It's easy. That's super advanced. Simple is super advanced, actually. But it's not a lethargic zombie simplification, right? No, they can fake it. Absurdity can fake it. No, we're very alert, very aware, very clear-minded, very much managing our success here. We know very clearly what we're focused on and what we're doing. And it's super simple, super easy, looking at this, just the premise here. We're able to look at the premise and see, okay, this is the problem. Okay, let's just see it. And